In all the hurry and hustle and confusion of modern living, the Lord has a way. We believe that the Bible is God's revelation of His way. We invite you to join us for In Search of the Lord's Way with Mac Lyon.
Welcome, my friend, to In Search of the Lord's Way. We're grateful that you've chosen this program over others you could have chosen, and we pray that you'll be blessed by it. We believe the Word of God is living and powerful. I mean, it's relevant in any age or civilization. And if we'll follow its teachings, it's the most efficacious means we have of changing our lives for the best. So we're not even trying to be spectacular or sensational. We're just trying to be biblical and relevant. The week of May 2nd, 1990, someone sent me a clipping from the Atlanta Journal and Constitution in which there was an Associated Press article that told of a man who was making arrangements to have his head frozen before his death so that after his body had died, his head might be attached to a healthy body and he could live again. In the procedure, he would be anesthetized while his body temperature is reduced. His head would be surgically removed, then saved in a vacuum container and maintained at 320 degrees below zero Fahrenheit until at some later date when it could be attached to another body. No, it isn't a joke. He's very serious about it. It's a process known as cryonic suspension. He's a mathematician and a member of Alcor Life Extension Foundation, and he had filed a suit in Santa Barbara County Superior Court in California so it could all be done legally. It seems to me to be another human attempt at immortality. It's another expression of man's strong desire to live on after death, to live again. If it worked, it'd certainly be an alternative to reincarnation, and it has much more credibility. Our program today addresses that universal concern about life after death. Jesus Christ offers the only real hope the human race has for it. We'll call our message, The Resurrection and Ascension of Christ. I'll be back right after Ken Helterbrand leads the congregation in a hymn. Reading the first four verses of the book of Romans. Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated unto the gospel of God, which he had promised afore by his prophets in the Holy Scriptures concerning his Son Jesus Christ our Lord, which was made of the seed of David according to the flesh, and declared to be the Son of God with power, according to the Spirit of holiness, by the resurrection from the dead. Now let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we're thankful for this good scripture and for all the others that promise us something of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and based on that also our resurrection from the dead. It's in Him that we have our only hope of living on beyond the grave. And we pray, Father, that You would bless our meditations on these verses to be a source of encouragement to those who need it at this hour. In His name we pray. Amen.
I'm a seed's God.
The idea that 3 days after his death, Jesus rose from the dead and is alive today 2,000 years later is so astounding that no sane person could be expected to believe it without an abundance of credible evidence. And though his resurrection has been given as one of the cardinal doctrines of Christianity from the very first day, many modern theologians and even pastors find difficulty in believing it. Oh, they give lip service to it, all right, with a resurrection sermon, special music, and all of that on Easter Sunday. But surveys show that many of them don't really believe it. Jesus' life was so characterized by miracles that his name has become virtually synonymous with the Word. He was miraculously conceived and born of a virgin. He himself believed that he possessed miraculous powers to heal people of all kinds of illnesses, to exorcise those who were demon-possessed, and even return the dead to life again. But the miracle of all miracles and the proof of all proofs was his resurrection from the dead. The passage which we read from the outset of our scripture reading today, he was powerfully declared to be God's Son according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection from the dead. McCord's translation. It's difficult to say how much of his claims and miracles his friends could comprehend or believe. Certainly they grasped enough of it that they were willing to commit their lives to him. They left their homes and their families and their businesses to become involved in his ministry. One of them even went so far as to say that he believed him to be the Messiah, the Christ, the Son of God. Presumably he spoke for the whole group, but just how firm that faith was, we're made to wonder a little later. The rising tide of opposition to Jesus, particularly from the religious leaders, came as a real shock to them, and his shameless crucifixion seemed to dash their hopes of his being Christ the Savior. Then suddenly, something happened that changed that apprehensive uncertainty into daring conviction. What was it? It was the discovery of the empty tomb. The tomb where they had laid him was empty. It's true. And immediately that little band of discouraged and disillusioned disciples became a vigorous and dynamic church, going all over the world, preaching and teaching the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Oh, if it could have been proven right then and right there. If just at that moment there had been one shred of evidence produced that Jesus Christ was not raised and that the story of the resurrection was a hoax and the disciples were deceived, the church could never have begun. The empty tomb. The question's never been whether the tomb was empty, but how to account for it. There seem to be only four real possibilities. Number one, the Lord's enemies stole the body. Two, his friends removed it from the tomb. Three, Jesus was not really dead, and when taken from the cross and buried in the cool tomb, he recovered, or he was resuscitated, and he got up and rolled away the stone from the entrance and walked off. And then four, resurrection. Oh, there have been other explanations, but none serious enough really to consider. Why would the enemies steal the body of Jesus? It was already in their possession. If they stole it, why didn't they produce it and prove right then, once and for all, that this resurrection story was mere fabrication? Well, it would have killed Christianity dead in its tracks right there. Why would Jesus' friends remove the body? To preach the resurrection story? No. No, that isn't it, because despite the fact that Jesus had told them he would rise from the dead, they neither understood it nor believed it. Furthermore, do you think for a moment they would have suffered beatings, imprisonment, and even death for what they knew in their own hearts was a falsehood? Well, what about that swoon theory? That he wasn't really dead and revived when he rested in the cool tomb? He was dead, all right. The Roman soldier removed all doubt of that when he pierced him with his spear. There was medical evidence of his death too, John 19, verse 34. But if not, could he have recovered sufficiently to have rolled away that huge stone at the entrance of the tomb? And what of the Roman seal and the guards? Well, the only other explanation for the empty tomb is resurrection. My friend, there is no event in history that is better documented than the resurrection of Jesus Christ. He showed himself alive by many infallible proofs, being seen by his apostles for 40 days, teaching them things about the kingdom, Acts chapter 1, verses 1 to 3. One of the most violent enemies Christianity has ever had. One who more than any other person imprisoned the disciples of Jesus, compelled them to blaspheme, persecuted them even to distant cities, testified against them when they were being put to death, Saul of Tarsus, who later became the Apostle Paul, wrote the most profound and definitive statement there is on the resurrection of Jesus Christ in 1 Corinthians 15. In it, he called to witness more than 500 people who had personally seen him after his resurrection, some of whom he called by name. Though he once thought it was heresy, Saul or Paul, who also saw him after his resurrection, was so convinced of the resurrection that he unreservedly committed the rest of his life to preaching the resurrection of Christ. And he says that the entire Christian faith depends on it. In 1 Corinthians 15, verse 12, he asks, "Now if Christ be preached that he rose from the dead, how say some among you that there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there is no resurrection of the dead, then is Christ not risen? And if Christ is not risen, then is our preaching vain. And your faith is also vain. Yea, and we are also found witnesses of God, because we have testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he raised not up at all, if so be that the dead rise not. For if the dead rise not, your faith is vain. You're yet in your sins. Then they also which are fallen asleep in Christ are perished. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we of all men most miserable are to be pitied." It's been said that the best evidence of the resurrection of Jesus Christ is the Christian church. It's true. What other religious leader established his movement on his own resurrection from the dead? It says, Perry B. Cotham wrote in the Gospel Advocate, June 1991, "If Christ arose from the dead, Christianity is true. If not, it's false." Either he rose from the dead or he did not rise from the dead, he said. But I think of the second strongest piece of evidence supporting the resurrection of Jesus Christ is the conversion in the life of Saul. Our text says he was powerfully declared to be God's son by the resurrection from the dead. By his resurrection, Jesus is no longer a person confined to one place, one nation, one race, one time, but universal, living, a presence, a Savior for all the world, and high priest living and interceding for every child of God universally. My friend Don Vincent, professor of Bible at Oklahoma Christian University, says, "Christianity's symbol shouldn't be a cross, but an empty tomb. Because we serve a risen and living Savior." On one of those frequent occasions when he was assembled with his disciples after his resurrection, Jesus told them, "All power or authority is given unto me in heaven and on earth." Matthew 28, verse 18. Sounds like God gave him authority or power or rule over all things. Doesn't it sound that way to you? Then while they watched, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfastly toward heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, which also said, Ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up in the heaven? This same Jesus which is taken up from you into heaven shall so come in like manner as you have seen him go into heaven. Acts 1, verses 9 to 11. What a glorious event and beautiful sight. That must have been a time of joy and excitement for those disciples. Wouldn't you love to have been there? Daniel saw it almost 6 centuries before it actually happened. I saw in the night visions, he said, in Daniel 7:13. And behold, one like the Son of Man came with the clouds of heaven and came to the Ancient of Days. And they brought him near before him. And there was given him dominion and glory and a kingdom that all people, nations, languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom that which shall not be destroyed. Then he did receive his kingdom, and Daniel's kingdom prophecies were fulfilled. In the very next chapter, describing the events of Pentecost, Peter spoke of the prophecy of David in the 16th chapter in verse 8, saying, Therefore, being a prophet, and knowing that God has sworn with an oath to him that of the fruit of his loins, according to the flesh, he would raise up Christ to sit on his throne. He, seeing this before, spake of the resurrection of Christ, that his soul was not left in Hades, neither his flesh did see corruption. This Jesus, he declared, hath God raised up, whereof we are all witnesses. Therefore, being by the right hand of God and exalted, and having received of the Father the promise of the Holy Ghost, he has shed forth that which you now see and hear. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God has made that same Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. Christ is Lord or ruler, my friend, over all things in heaven and in earth. Isn't it strange that many of the very people who wear the lapel pins and bumper stickers saying, Christ is Lord, really don't believe that? They don't believe that he's received his kingdom and he reigns over it today. The Holy Spirit says that God raised Christ from the dead and set him at his own right hand in heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this world, but in that which is to come, and hath put all things under his feet and gave him to be head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. Ephesians 1, verses 22 through 23. In another place, this time by the pen of Peter, he's speaking of Christ when he says, He is gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, angels and authorities and powers being made subject unto him. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 22. In Eastern and Roman culture, to sit on the right hand of the emperor was the same as sharing his political and military power. This role of co-regent was usually reserved for the oldest son in the family. And by using this language in these passages, the Holy Spirit is saying that Jesus Christ, God's only Son, is seated now at the Father's right hand and rules the world. And he will rule till he comes again, when he will deliver the kingdom over which he now reigns to the Father and become subject unto him. 1 Corinthians 15, verses 24 through 26. Loving Father in heaven, we're so thankful for the assurances that you have given us in your word and the strength they provide us that Jesus Christ really was raised from the dead, and that he ascended to your own right hand and lives there and intercedes for us today and rules over the events of this world. the entire world and principalities and powers, and even the angelic beings being subject to Him. Thank you, Father, for such a Savior and such a Lord in His name. Amen. The resurrection and ascension of Jesus the Christ are two fundamental doctrines of the Christian faith. Faith in them gives meaning to becoming and being a Christian, and without such a faith, a Christian profession is weak and listless. The Apostle Paul said that the preaching of the cross, and that is the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ, was to the Jews a stumbling block. To the Greeks, it is foolishness. You see, to the Jewish people, the dead body was repulsive and it was unclean. And to talk to them about the resurrection of that dead body, well, it was a stumbling block. And to try to tell the Gentile people that the body had been raised after 3 days in the grave, well, it was just foolishness to them. But Peter declares that according to his abundant mercy, God has begotten us again unto a living hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. We have hope in Christ, and we are born again to that new hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. So we're born again to a living hope by the resurrection of Christ. And then he explains it in 1 Peter 3:21, where he says, by baptism, a person appeals to God for a good conscience by the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Paul says, if you don't believe in the resurrection of Christ, what faith you have is vain, and our preaching is vain, meaningless. Just as the resurrection of Christ made a significant change in the lives of the apostles, so it makes a difference in the lives of the 20th century disciples. Such conviction will once more put vigor and victory into the individual Christian's life and into the ministry of the church. We don't need hype, hand-clapping, foot-stomping, hallelujah pep rallies to make the church appear to be alive and alert. We only need a deep-down conviction of the precious truths of the gospel of Jesus Christ. No, my friend, cryonic suspension is not the answer to man's desire for life after death, nor is reincarnation our hope. Jesus Christ is our hope. If you're not a Christian, I hope you'll become so today. If you'd like to study it further, let us hear from you. Perhaps we can study by correspondence, or maybe someone can come by your house and study with you. Why not worship with us? Attend the Bible classes of the Church of Christ near you there. If you need help in locating one of those churches, we'd be glad to work with you and help you in locating one. If you can use a free audio cassette tape or a printed copy of today's program titled The Resurrection and the Crucifixion of Christ, or The Ascension of Christ, The Resurrection and the Ascension of Christ, you may have it by writing In Search of the Lord's Way, Post Office Box 371, Edmond, Oklahoma 73083. Or you may call on our toll-free telephone number, 1-800-321-8633. Just ask for the program on the resurrection. You don't need to send money. It's free. But do tell us whether you want the printed copy or the cassette tape. This is a ministry of caring Christians in churches of Christ. It isn't a fundraising, a money-making appeal or effort that we're in. We want to thank you for being with us today. I do hope you've been blessed by the message and by our singing and praying together. And I hope you'll be with us again next week. Until then, I pray that God will keep on blessing you. I really mean it. We do love you.